Systems theory. Systems theory is all about what it sounds like, system, and it's the theory of systems, which involves a study of their components, how the components interact, and basically the dynamics of systems. So let's go ahead and look at first what a system is. We'll define a system as a collection of objects where those objects undergo change. And when I speak of change, I'm referring to dynamics. So change and dynamics go hand in hand. Sometimes people also use the word behavior when they speak of change. And behavior is okay. It's just that sometimes the word behavior has the connotation attached to some organic creature, human, a dog or a cat or some other kind of animal. But so often when people speak about behavior, they are usually talking about the behavior of someone, not something. But if you imagine behavior to be all-encompassing about anything, the behavior of my cup as I push it over, then in that case, behavior can be seen as being equivalent to dynamics. So a system then is the collection of objects, and it undergoes dynamical change. A system can be quite broad. It doesn't have to be one particular thing. The idea behind systems theory is it's an all-encompassing general theory about all scenes involving objects that undergo change. So for an example, a computer is an example of a system because it's a collection of objects and it's dynamic. Other examples might be a human might be considered a system. A clock might be considered a system. Each of these are objects, and they have a lot of sub-objects that interact and move, undergo change. The M1 A1 Abrams main battle tank is an example of a system, as is the battle that might include the tank as a small component. That is also a system. So within the idea of system, we have encapsulation and multiple levels of detail and abstraction, and the ideas of hierarchy are kind of built into what it means to be a system. A system might be a business operation. For instance, you might talk about the system of IBM, the IBM accounts payable receivable system, or something equivalent within Amazon. Maybe a supply chain process inside of the company Amazon might be considered a system, or Microsoft or any other company that you might think of. All right, so let's go ahead then and first take a look at system components. What makes up a system? First thing is that systems are composed of physical objects. This is a result of our natural language. We speak of objects. We speak of computers. We speak of coffee cups. We speak of pens and people and the thousands of objects that are all around us. So objects have certain behaviors and dynamics, and they also have certain attributes. And these are also part of a system. But critical parts of a system will begin with objects and then proceed to something we call states. Now, states take a duration of time or an activity. So one example is in physics, we think of state as being equivalent to the concept phase. So when you have something in chemistry or physics and you speak of the word phase, this particular process is undergoing a phase or a phase transition or phase change. The phase itself is considered a state because it takes a particular amount of time within that phase for the system to undergo various changes. When it undergoes a transition, then we will speak of event, which we'll get to shortly. Now in English, when you look at participle phrases, that's what best matches the idea of state. So if you're frying pancakes or running to the goal line, these are participle phrases because you have the verb forms, you have heating, running, and these denote or connote activities that take a certain amount of time. And therefore, that's the kind of thing that you have in a state. It's an object that undergoes change, and certain of its attributes change over time. But and yet, they can all be clustered together in this thing called state. So we often talk about a state of an object. And so with our just examples, when we heat pancakes, that would be a state of a human, because the human presumably would be the one that would be frying or heating the pancakes. Also, running to the goal line, that would be perhaps a football player, and that would be an object that would be running to the goal line, and thus running to the goal line defines the state of that object. Other examples of states that are inside objects that are humans: waking up, turning off the alarm clock, picking up the paper, going to work. These are all examples of states. State inside an operating system for a computer might be, you might have the state of running a computer job, waiting on a signal to be produced by a device. The process of waiting itself is a state. Outputting to a printer would be a state, typing on a keyboard. The state is represented as a point or region of state space. So this is something that we'll get to a little bit later on, but we talk about state space. It's something that you hear in various subjects and disciplines. That people talk about the state space, and that really just means the set of all of the states that you might be considering for a system. Next, we look at events. Events are like the glue that separates states or combines states together. You combine states together with events. They are the complements of events. So you can, if you think of a state as white, an event would be black. The I Ching symbol might give you a sort of a convenient reference or an icon for imagining the complementarity involving states and events. All right, so what is an event exactly? It complements states, and an example would be a calendar of events. This is something that most organizations produce. Most large organizations produce a calendar of events, activities that are going to go on. The way that state is specified theoretically is that you've got a state at one point in time. So an event is a state at one particular point in time. In physics, events are used often when speaking of light events, for instance, or sound events. So in relativity theory, where you are speaking of electromagnetic radiation or light in the broadest sense, then you're referring to points in event space, or again, state and time, where you have intersections of objects with light. An important aspect of states and events is that they can occur over multiple scales, multiple levels of abstraction. So a region of state space may be a point, or it might actually be a set or a partition of state space. and it really just depends on the level that you're interested in. An example may be that if you're waking up, getting out of bed, this involves articulated joint motions. So joints and their motions, presumably, if you were to model them at great detail, you would have your leg, you would have your hip, you would have your torso, and these would have positional attributes associated with them. They would have angles, they would have X and Y and Z variables and attributes. But if you want to abstract all of that away, you can simply look at waking up as a point in state space. So it is a point in state space where the space itself has other points that are at that same level of abstraction as waking up. But if you want to get into the nitty-gritties, then you can dive down into the XYZ positions of your joints. It all depends on the goal of the modeling that you're doing with systems and what level that you want to work at. An event at one level may be a state at another. For instance, going to work can be considered either a state or an event. It really depends on the level of abstraction, and it depends on the demarcation of an event boundary separating two states. So if you have, for instance, the states being at home and being at work, then going to work can be considered an event because it's a point in time that is attached to a human that could be going to work, and it separates two states. But it can be a state if you want to zoom into it and realize that going to work actually involves a lot more things, like pulling out of the driveway, finding your way to the interstate if you use interstate, driving down the road. I mean, there are a lot of other things that are going on that could be easily part of one state or multiple states. So it depends on how high or low you want to work when you're referring to a system in terms of different levels of abstraction. Time plays a critical role, certainly in systems theory and the definition of systems. It's treated as orthogonal to the other elements, objects, states, and events, and separate from other components. In physics, we know time is relative to the observer, but in the average sense of space-time, the average being what the human observes in human scale in terms of spaces and time. It is a separate entity. We also have space. It could be either discrete or continuous. We'll get to the discrete or continuous aspect in just a moment, but let's just look at space. Space can be divided into different geometric realms. If you are dealing with rectangular space, then you're looking at a Cartesian coordinate system, which is usually defined as rectangular. But from geometry, you may remember that there are spherical coordinate systems, there are cylindrical coordinate systems, and it depends which you use in order to think about your system. If you're looking at rectangular, you're usually using the letters X, Y, and Z, for example, as they represent a rectangular frame of reference. Now, space may be only there may be independent variable, or it may be a dependent variable. For continuous time or space, ordinary differential equations, or ODEs, may involve space, but in those particular cases, time is the only independent variable. Space is not an independent variable. If space is an independent variable, then we would progress from ODEs to partial differential equations, which involve things like x and y, for example, being independent. Now, just a note before we leave, I mentioned that we talk about discrete versus continuous. Discrete basically means that you've got points in time. So when you deal with time, you're dealing with either a finite set or at least a countable set of times. They may not be regular times necessarily. They may be irregularly spaced times on an axis. Whereas continuous, the idea is that regardless of what interval of time you might look at, if you zoom into that interval, you can find more times. And of course, calculus is where you find a study of continuum and continua. This is generally where in mathematics you study that, whereas in discrete mathematics, you don't use calculus, you use other methods. So typically in systems, you'll often hear discrete systems, discrete event, discrete state. And the reason why people often differentiate discrete versus continuous is based on the fact that the mathematical methods are often different, quite different in handling a discrete time or state system than they are from handling a continuous time or state system. Again, with continuous systems, heavy use of the calculus is made, whereas discrete systems, it is not. Let's proceed to mathematical structure. If we're going to represent the system as a structure, what does it look like? And the first thing is, what is a structure? Mathematical structure stems from set theory. Set theory is one of the most basic theories involved in mathematics. And a structure is really nothing more than a collection or a set, or an ordered set sometimes, of sets, relations, and functions. And that sounds very simple, and yet that's one of the powers of providing this definition in a mathematical framework, is that structures are simple in that sense. They're just sets, relations, and functions. And the way that those relations and functions are mapped onto sets really defines the dynamics of the particular system that's under study. Okay, now this somewhat arcane looking expression, I'll just read it from left to right, but a generic system, whether it's a computer, a human, a battle, can be abstractly represented as this tuple, what's called a tuple, or an ordered set. And for instance, we have T for time, U for input, Y for output, and Q for state. All of those first four things are basic sets. T is the set, for instance, of numbers that or letters that will be associated with time. If you've got real or floating point time, then it's T is equal to R, or being the set of real numbers. Okay, U is the input set, Y is the output set, Q is the state set. Now these sets can be infinite, they can be finite, they can be uncountable, they can be countable. It depends on the system that you're defining. Then you have three Greek letters after Q. You've got omega, which is the set of admissible input functions. You've got delta. And delta, really, if you look at delta, delta is the mathematical abstraction of dynamics in many ways, because it refers to the transition. It is the transition function that says we're in this state and we need to go to another state. And how that is done is dictated by delta. Lambda is how the system manifests itself to the outside world in terms of the observer. In other words, it's the output. What is the output of the system? Well, the output of a system refers to what kinds of measurements are made, or how, in the simplest sense, if you're just a human looking at the system, what is visible, what is audible. These are examples of outputs. Let's go ahead and take a closer look at the definition of system. Okay, first of all, what do we have? We've got time. We've got U. We have Y, Q, Omega, Delta, and Lambda. And the system is actually enclosed in these angle brackets, because typically angle brackets, the left angle bracket being right here, and the right angle bracket being right here, denote the concept of mathematical structure. So when we speak of structures or tuples, then this is what we have, the angle bracket followed by everything in between. Okay, now time is certainly something that can be, say, integers, set of integers, or it could be a set of reals. Sometimes a set of integers is denoted as z. You may sometimes see this notation. And then r often has a sort of similar kind of font like that. Kind of fancy looking kind of thing. So if time is then a set of integers, we have this. If it's a set of positive integers with zero, you might have a notation that starts with z0 and it says something like that. And then this would basically say that time would be equal to I, or would be equal to z0 plus some notation like this. Mathematics, one of the reasons it's a little bit hard to read is it's got a lot of different symbols, and you've got the concept of superscript and subscript. But if you know what those symbols are, then you can accurately determine the meaning. When we look at input, we're looking at another set. And again, this can be the set of reals, it could be the set of integers. Same thing with y. You have the same thing there. Q, again, if supposing that you were dealing, supposing you wanted to know what Q was, and we're referring to, say, the state of a light bulb. Well, the state of a light bulb might be on or off, so Q might be 0 or 1. It might be the set 0 or 1. It's just an example of what Q might be. But there's no reason why you need to go ahead and have Q like that. Here, we'll just go ahead and take this out. And instead of that, we'll just say that Q for the light bulb is off and on. We can do that too. There's absolutely nothing stopping us from using letters, numbers, mixtures of those twos, of those two things, or names. Okay, so this particular area then right around here, these are just elements of the system structure that represent simple sets. When we look at these over here, we're speaking of functions, which are a little bit more powerful. Now, let's take a look at this first function. Okay, we'll draw a line right here, and we'll take a look at omega, which is the set of admissible input functions. What does that mean? It means it's actually a set of functions. Each one of those functions looks like this. I'm going to draw functions graphically by using a little axis. And this will specify this as time. And we'll specify the kind of y or vertical direction of this as being u. So u, of course, was this guy right up here, right? And when we look at u here, that refers to the input set over time. And the input might be a binary input. We might be looking at, say, 1 and 0. And 1 for some particular point in time, this represents a curve within this space right here. And this represents a curve that is a function. And so that's how we define that. Now, this is just one example. The set omega then might be equal to the set of this function, 1, as well as 1 for 0. So we'll just kind of make that a little bit bold down here. Normally, when we draw sets, we don't draw them graphically like this, but this gives you some idea of what omega might be. It's a set of all functions which can represent the time-based input to the system. Now, you may wonder, well, time, that's interesting, but where does time fit in here? I mean, clearly, we've drawn the length of this particular line, this segment, for a certain amount of time, right? And that can be anything you want. This distance right here can be 1 millisecond, it can be 1 second, it can be 100 years. It depends on the system that you're dealing with. But you will probably have individual segments that have a specific length of time associated with them, with each segment being a function. Okay, so there we've defined omega, or the set of admissible input functions which drives the system. Now, when we look at transition, the transition function, we're looking at delta. And the way that delta is normally defined, and I'm just going to use the notation for functions, is I'm going to say that it is a function from the following set. I'm going to say it's a set from Q, and that's across omega to Q. So the way we read this is the delta function right here, and that this delta function is a function from this domain right here to this range over here. So we say that it is a function from the state set and an admissible input to the state set. In English, that just means that the transition function takes a state, takes an input to the system identified by an element of the set omega, and maps that to another state in the system, which is just the way of saying that we move from one state in the system to another using our input, which drives deterministically the system. The last thing left in our system definition is this right here, which is lambda. And often this can be defined in different ways, but one way of defining it is to say it's a function from the state set, and then we run out of a little bit of room here, and we would say the state set to the output set, and the output set is y. Okay, so this overall gives us some definitions for and descriptions of what we're dealing with in terms of the systems theoretic thing. Let's go ahead and erase this, and let's just overview what a system looks like. Okay, you can think graphically of the system in a very general way. Is here's a system boundary like that. So this is the system. Now you're going to have an input to the system, and you're going to have an output from the system. The way to look at that is the input drives the system into different states, and some of those states are changed with events occurring in between the states. And then the system undergoes a number of different state changes, some of which are observable. Those which are observable are called output. If they are not observable, then they're not output. They're only output if they can be observed. So when you see output, you can imagine that there's somebody actually looking at this system. Or you can imagine that someone has hooked up a multimeter or some kind of sensing device that senses and reads off something from the system that tells us tells them some information about the system. So inside the system itself, you can just imagine you've got these individual state changes from one state to the next.